Yo. What is up, Chocolate Taco? We're here on a beautiful Tuesday night.
In person.
Fantastic weekend of barbecue, tacos, tequila.
A lot of tequila, a lot of fun.
And some football.
Football, a little bit of football. I mean, we did watch football.
Every single day.
But did we watch as much as we probably wanted?
I think we spent more time watching Saturn and Uranus and Mars.
We did.
Maybe football one night.
We were space explorers on Saturday night.
We were. It was a good night. It's a good weekend. Great weekend of football. And it's going to be a great week of football as we turn the page into week 7 now of the NFL season. And these weeks, Matty, Kiwoom, chugga. They're just cooking.
Cannot believe it.
Flying by. But tonight, we're going to get started with a little buy or sell.
Mm-hmm.
Then we're going to go into the awards of the week. And then we're going to finish it out with the hurdle. So, again, we're not going to be answering any questions in chat tonight because we did pre-record this, but we do appreciate you. We do love you, and we would love to comment back and forth with you after the video is over. So please drop a comment for us. Let us know if you like this format of the show, because if you do love it, and if we do get, 10,000 views, maybe 10,000 views, I'll move to Massachusetts.
we'll set up the flight. I'll fly in, record, fly out. If you get 10,000 views, 10,000 views, 10,000 likes.
We'll do it.
Let's make it happen.
It's that easy. All right. Let's start out with some buy or sell, Medic. Mm-hmm. First thing that comes to mind, again, this player, team-centric, fantasy-centric, it's across the board, or across, as I like to tell Alex Dunlap, with a T at the end of it. First thing that comes to mind from week 6 and the first part of the season.
Buy or sell, the Washington Commanders win the NFC East.
I think I'm going to go buy here. I'll start with the bottom. The Giants actually looked decent on Sunday Night Football. The game sucked.
The game was absolutely dog water.
But Tyrone Tracy looked good.
Yeah.
Darius Slayton looked respectable. Wandale looked fine. I mean, I would like to see some more Theo Johnson. Speaking of buy or sell, the theory of it, a guy I like to buy in theory is Theo Johnson. We have a lot of Theo Johnson, but buy some more Theo Johnson if I'm in Dynasty. Giants obviously dead last. Cowboys and Eagles to me right now are a bit of a toss-up. The Cowboys get completely run through.
They got dog walked at home. The Detroit Lions coming off a bye, rolled into Dallas, and not only beat the Cowboys, destroyed the Cowboys, made the Cowboys reconsider everything. And now I think what we're going to start seeing is this snowball cascading effect of bad decisions from the tippity top. Whether it be letting Mike McCarthy come back and not letting him go instead of getting, a Bill Belichick, for instance, letting the whole Dak Prescott thing roll out, letting CeeDee Lamb roll out, not getting a resolution on Micah Parsons, because now they're in a situation where do you trade for Micah Parsons? Do you trade him away?
Yeah.
Feels kind of like they're in a crossroads. So, yeah, I think you put the Eagles and the Cowboys in the same boat, that they're fine. I mean, the Eagles, on the other hand, coming off a bye, you'd think they were going to be ready to go against the Browns. The Browns suck, and they didn't. They allowed the Browns to stick around. And honestly, if the Browns just made a handful more plays, they could have won that game. And Jerome Ford left early with a hamstring injury. Again, another game with Amari Cooper getting all the targets under the blue sky, only catching about half of them. So there was a lot of opportunity to slip by the Browns. So the Eagles don't impress me. But even in defeat, I would say the most impressive team in the NFC East this week was the Commanders. The Washington Commanders, they lose to Lamar Jackson and the Baltimore Ravens, but they had a chance. They were fighting there till the very end. And Jaden Daniels once again puts another good game together. Good completion percentage, over 280 passing yards, 2 touchdowns, both to Terry Mack. There's a good rapport going between Terry McLaurin and Jaden Daniels, which we love to see in fantasy. Terry McLaurin finally has a guy that can get him the rock. For me, I think the NFC East championship, not the NFC championship, the NFC East is going to go through Washington.
So through the first 6 weeks going into the bye, Dallas lost to New Orleans by 25, the Ravens by 3, and the Lions by 38. They have a bye now after they have 3-point win against the Steelers, 5-point win against the Giants, and a 16-point win in week 1 against the Browns. Listen to this. At the Niners, night game, Sunday night.
And they always historically get dog, well, over the last few years, get dog walked by the Niners.
Then, a week later, at Atlanta. So we're going out to San Fran, back home, out to Atlanta.
Mm-hmm.
Not a good two-gapper out of the bye.
Atlanta's playing pretty decent, too.
Home against Philly.
Tough game.
Divisional game. Home against Houston.
Tough game. Real tough game.
Commanders. At Commanders.
Ooh, so the first time that they engage with Jane Daniels, the Commanders, is on the road.
And it's after that gauntlet. It's after that gauntlet.
I mean, the Commanders might be welcoming in the Cowboys at this point in the season atop the NFC East with a real chance of making an exclamation mark and really put down, I'm not going to call it a beat down this early, you know, this far away. But stylistically, Commanders match up pretty good with the Cowboys.
Commanders, after that 7-point loss to the Ravens, they have Carolina at home, Chicago at home, at the Giants, home against the Steelers. Very favorable next four games before they enter NFC East talk or games with at the Eagles and then the Cowboy game. So I like it. I'll buy it. I'll buy Washington Commanders winning the NFC East. My question for you, Matty Kiwoom, is going to go to the West Coast now. And to the West Coast, I go, I saw a tweet you made. We were walking together. We were talking together. We were drinking together. We were eating together. We were hanging out.
Vibing together. Enjoying Charleston. Charleston's beautiful.
And we didn't exactly get to watch all the games live. We went back and watched them after. But we didn't get to watch them live, mostly. But we did, however, keep up with some stuff.
Oh, yeah.
My buy or sell, Matty. Bo Nix is the second best quarterback in this draft class to this point. And he should be in discussions to be a top 12 dynasty quarterback.
I'm going to sell both, but I will say this. It's really a semantics argument for me. It's not the overall sentiment I'll buy. I will buy that. Back-to-back weeks, I know we're recording earlier, so we don't know Josh Allen and Aaron Rodgers on Monday night. QB8, back-to-back QB8 weeks, so potentially back-to-back top 12 weeks for sure, so QB1 weeks.
Yep.
He's rushed the ball 6 times a game throughout the whole season, 60 yards this past weekend. The touchdowns are coming, and now we've had, what, six touchdowns over his last 2 games, 5 touchdowns over the last 2 games. Bo Nix is playing well. He's playing poised, and we talked about this at the beginning of the season. His weaponry smells. It stinks. I am worried about Courtland Sutton. I'd like to know your thoughts on Courtland because, again, he's producing, but Sutton just is not having explosive games. We see Troy Franklin catch a touchdown.
Finally.
He should have had one. He should have back-to-back touchdowns. He dropped one that was in the breadbasket a week ago. So I'm going to sell because Caleb's pitching perfect games. These last 2 weeks, Caleb's coming into his own.
Yeah.
We did get to sit and watch that game.
That was the question.
Right. And with Jaden playing the way how good Jaden is, and Caleb, you know, taking care of business in London last week against the Jaguars, you know, these good teams are supposed to beat the bad ones. Yeah. And these quarterbacks are meant to beat the bad matchups. And he did that. And he did not struggle at all. 4 touchdowns. Could have been 5 had DJ Moore gotten the end zone there at the end on that little pop pass. And something I was a little bit, I'm not going to necessarily call it worried. I don't know if I was worried per se, but something I was absolutely keeping an eye on was the development of Shane Waldron as offensive coordinator. And now he's starting to cook. Waldron's starting to put together some nice plays, some good stretches of scheme. That touchdown, the first touchdown to Cole Kmet, the double screen, Ezzy hit Cole Kmet in the seam for 31-yard touchdown. So I like what I'm seeing out of Caleb Williams. Now, as a top 12 dynasty guy, I would, again, it's a matter of semantics, but if you want to say he's in the top 15, man, that consideration is absolutely there for Bo Nix.
Bo Nix, Trevor Lawrence.
Give me Bo Nix.
Bo Nix, Herbert.
Give me Bo Nix. We knew this coming into the
year. It's kind of his comp.
Yeah, I mean, but Herbert is going to understand what winning tastes like, what winning feels like, but he's going to come at the expense of production. We see that now.
Which is what fantasy football is.
We need production, so I would absolutely take Bo Nix because, you know, shootouts, catch-up mode, that is all kind of what we really like for these.
Anthony players. Richardson banged up this week, didn't play. Flacco played. Anthony Richardson's 47%, 50%, 50% in his three games he's played this year. Not good. Got the rushing. 22 years old. But do you trust Indianapolis to deal with him correctly, Richardson or Knicks?
I'm going to go Richardson, and here's why. It's really more of a Justin Fields type corollary where Fields' value as he was running for 200 yards against the Miami Dolphins 3 years ago was at peak, right? And then we saw it completely fall off this past summer, only for it to retain more value because that rushing ability, the ability to score touchdowns in fantasy football, get rushing yards in fantasy football, keeps you relevant. So I'm going to apply a little of that mystique, a little of that magic to Anthony Richardson. I mean, Richardson was a top five guy. Anthony Richardson was a top eight guy coming into the year, dynasty-wise. The value for him was immense. So I'm going to go with Richardson, but man, it's a hell of a lot closer than I would have thought it had been a couple months ago.
I just moved him back-to-back with Richardson. I think I'm kind of in the same spot. I'm not quite ready to do it. I'll put him a touch behind Richardson. So that's QB 13.
But that slope is steep for Richardson because now the Colts are looking at a decision where should we redshirt him? Should we let Flacco play out the year?
Yes.
Let him get it? Because remember, Richardson did not have a developmental rookie year. He was hurt week four, whatever it was, missed the rest of the season, didn't get a chance to learn, didn't get a chance to develop. This could be his redshirt year and get a chance to kind of understand the game from a true pro's pro, Joe Flacco. And I think that there's a non-zero chance we see a injury for Richardson that puts him kind of in the back burner. I mean, he was QB3 on the depth chart going into last night's game. So that was indicator that, okay, you need to just relax. Don't have your helmet anywhere near you. Get the headset on. Get the clipboard out. Whatever they're allowing him to do to learn. That's priority one for Anthony Richardson, which I think is good for him and his development, especially with a guy like Steichen who's a good offensive mind. He's going to learn. And then a guy like Flacco that can help him prepare properly, get ready properly. So I like that for his long-term outlook. But if you were hoping that Anthony Richardson was going to be your QB1 all year, your big-time saving grace, your monster, it seems like that boat is quickly shipping out.
All right, you ready to do awards?
Let's do some awards.
All right, so
awards time!
Remember last week we did the Nathan Peterman Award, which is the biggest dud, the biggest loser of the week. We have the Rising Star, which is the biggest value boost bump, and the Amari Dupe of the week, which is the biggest performance that we ain't trusting.
We ain't trusting it. What was yours last week, the dupe? Did that work this week?
I don't even remember.
Mine was Garrett Wilson. We haven't seen that game yet, so I can't speak to.
I need to go back and listen to it. To be honest with you. I don't even remember. You want to start out with the Amari Dupe of the week?
Let's start with the Amari Dupe of the week. For me, my Amari Dupe of the week has to be Sean Tucker. Not that I don't like the player, but Rashad White comes back. Bucky Irving is not going to be put away. And what we saw in Sean Tucker was, you know.
How dare you?
It was 150 total yards for a touchdown. He was an absolute monster in fantasy. I don't think that they can, he won't be inactive going forward. That's for sure. But they're not just going to, Rashad White didn't get Wally pipped.
Mm-hmm.
And I just don't like to chase efficiencies on a weekly basis. And odds are, other than best ball format, he wasn't in many lineups this week. So you definitely missed his best game of the season. He's not going to have a better game than this.
Yeah.
And I think that to chase it next week would be a bit of a fool's errand. So he's going to be my Amari Dupe of the week. But in terms of getting himself on the radar, getting himself now being sought after in fantasy markets, that's big. Now, are you buying or selling him in Dynasty right now?
Well, you can't.
That's the question.
You can't buy him.
The price is...
Well, it's at minimum. I don't even know if you could get him for a second round pick.
If you... Right, but even that, isn't that a bit pricey?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I don't even know if you could get him for that.
Right.
Do you think you could?
I think you could. I think in most savvy leagues, you know, most marketplaces in terms of fantasy, the hemming and hawing will be third to second. And I think that most people who are looking to sell, because if you had Richard, like let's just say you had White, you picked up Tucker because you lost White, that guy ain't going to sell Tucker because you're just going to keep the backfield. But for the rando that picked up Tucker and had him on the bench, didn't need him, obviously, because they were playing other players, I think right now the second rounder is the one that's going to be the push through that's going to get it through. I think third, you can potentially get him for third. Either way, though, I would do a third, but a second, I'm just not willing to get into that level yet. We're a couple weeks away from those seconds getting you bona fide starters.
Yeah. And I still like Rashad White.
I still believe in Rashad White. I don't know how I can at this point, because now it looks like there are two guys behind him that can run the ball better. And then we saw Bucky Irving score a touchdown, get a call back because he's down at the one. They gave it right back to him the very next play. He stuffed it in there. He's not going anywhere. He's really kind of coming into his own in terms of what he provides the Buccaneers. And now Sean Tucker's not going to die. Sean Tucker's not going to die, but I think he's the mirage of the weekend to chase, 30 fantasy points is a bit lofty.
All right. Mine's not quite a 30 burger because it was Tucker yards like RB1 this week, wasn't he?
He's got to be. He's got to be, right?
I think he's pretty clear cut. I'm going to go to Chicago here. Two players in this game had 5 targets, 5 receptions, 2 touchdowns. And the one that I'm going to fade away from and call the Amari Dupe of the week is Keenan Allen.
Mm-hmm.
Because he's the 32-year-old in this offense that we haven't seen quite do it this year. This is an odd game. I mean, Jacksonville's shit.
They're bad. Their secondary's terrible.
And he's 32 years old, and we like DJ Moore. We like Roma Dunsey. We like Cole Kmet. DeAndre Swift has turned it on the last few weeks.
Yes, he has.
I think we believe those counterparts. The Keenan Allen thing, this is your last window.
Right.
This is your last window to sell. A 32-year-old Keenan Allen. If someone's like, I got to win a championship, what are we now? Week 7. So I'm 1-5. I'm 2-5. You know, 1-5 people, maybe not, but,
Well, this is
3-3 teams.
Yeah, so these are the teams that,
Keenan Allen.
I need to get a player that's going to help me get out of the muck.
Yeah.
Because right now, most fantasy leagues, if you have a tough league where it's very competitive, odds are there's maybe an outlier or two at the top, an outlier or two at the bottom, and the rest from 3 to, if you're in a 12-team league, 9, 10 even, is within a game of each other. And if you're trying to kind of propel yourself up, there are going to be people that are going to be looking to buy Keenan Allen right now, especially going into the bye where, that narrative could be spun a different way, that Keenan Allen's emerged now, and he's a big-time target, yada, yada, yada. But what I would say this, too, if you watch the game, you'll know that one of the touchdowns came from Keenan Allen when DJ Moore on the sidelines got poked in the eye. So he had missed a couple snaps. And DJ Moore almost had 2 touchdowns. He was severely underthrown for one that should have been a tud. A ball Caleb Williams would absolutely like to have back. He even mentioned it.
He was so
at the end of the game.
He's like, oh, I don't want to miss. And he missed.
And he so missed. And when they asked him about his performance, he went to that and said, there are things you need to get better at, things you need to clean up. I had DJ for a wide open touchdown. I missed him. And then that pop pass, if DJ wasn't able to extend as opposed to getting kind of driven to the ground head first, he would cross the goal line. So that'd be 2 touchdowns for DJ Moore, and he would just be right in lockstep. And then when you look at the surface, it's bubbling underneath. That Roma Dunsey.
Dude, every week it feels like it's almost there.
Super Saiyan game. I know he had a big game a couple weeks ago against the Colts, but it feels like it's simmering underneath, and it's gonna be a massive, massive unleashing soon.
Let's move on to the Nathan Peterman dud or loser of the week. Disappointing. Something we were looking up to. I think last week the biggest one was Dontavian Wicks.
Yes.
With all them drops. What do you got this week?
This week, my Nathan Peterman dud of the week, it pains me to say it, Antonio Gibson. No Ramondre Stevenson. I know the matchup was tough in terms of the run defense of the Houston Texans, but the game script aligned perfectly for his skill set. And 13 carries for 19 yards is just not going to get you more touches when Ramondre gets back. He did finish with 43 total yards, but he didn't even eclipse double-digit fantasy points in a matchup where, I had started him over guys like Najee Harris in the league. I had started him in my flex over a number of other players. So for him to get the opportunity, because we've seen him be efficient, just a week ago, we saw him at 5 touches for 50 yards. We show, oh man, the burst, the explosion, the go-ness. And this week, to have the 13 carries, to be on the field as much as he was, to only convert to 43 total yards, it's disheartening, and it's a loser of the week for me because now it doesn't do him any favors of carving out more of a role. Like Sean Tucker did a lot to carve out a role going forward. If Antonio Gibson, had 100 yards from scrimmage, was effective, was able to kind of propel Drake Maye in that offense going forward. He would have carved out more touches, but what he just affirmed to coaching staff and everybody else, it's Ramondre when he's healthy, and he's the speller. And that's just probably not going to provide much fantasy the rest of the year.
I'm going to go to another running back that, Matty, if you had Rashad White and this guy on your team, you'd score more points playing Rashad White this week. And Rashad White did what this week?
Did not play.
Did not play. You'd have scored more points with Rashad White on your team than this guy. This guy's prop number was at like 41.5 rushing yards this week, and your boy took the over because I was like, dude, I mean, these numbers, it's like the Mark Andrews thing. I played him this week in DFS, and it was like a maniacal thing. One of the better lineups, I think maybe the best lineup I've ever built.
Where'd you finish?
Hung over his tits, and I was like, you know what? I've been building one, a single entry lineup every single week, and I usually enter like a $27 or a $50 league on DraftKings. And I usually do decent. I don't win a bunch. I usually at least break even, maybe win 20, 30, 40 bucks. Whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
So this week, hungover's tits. We do our shows, and I'm got a migraine, and I go like lay down for 5 minutes. And I go, I better punch one in quick.
Yeah, I got to tap one in.
I punched this lineup together with Sean Tucker in it.
Yeah.
Maniacal.
Mark Andrews. Yep.
And Tank Dell, you know, there's a couple other good guys. It was a good lineup.
It was a good lineup.
But it was Mark Andrews and Sean Tucker that made the lineup.
Godwin, you had Godwin in there.
I had Godwin, but Mark Andrews was 30. This is the premise. The point of this is Mark Andrews was 3,900.
Yeah.
Which is, you don't get that. Usually he's 7,800, right, in our the last 5 years of our life. And with Travis Etienne, and this is where I'm going to tie this back to, Travis Etienne, his rushing number was 41.5 rushing yards this week. Mm-hmm. And you're like, well, I've seen him do that on one carry how many times? Okay. Yeah. So last week they tell us after he's out rushed by Tank Bigsby and he catches 6 receptions on 7 targets, he's asked, is Etienne benched? Is this Bigsby? Is he starting? No, this is Etienne's backfield. This week.
We love Etienne.
Matty, I believe that says 3 carries for minus 1 yard. And that says 1 target, nothing.
Yeah. Yeah.
For Travis Etienne. So 4 opportunities, 3 carries, negative 1 yard, tiddly squat, dink nuts, nothing.
Worse than that, minus something. If you play in decimal scoring, he was a minus 0.01 or minus 0.1, whatever it is. He got you minus points.
And Lawrence threw the ball 35 times. He threw for 234 yards. They got walked like puppy dogs. Mm-hmm. And the backfield accounted for 3 targets. D'Ernest Johnson came in for mop-up duty. He had 2 receptions for 16 yards. Travis Etienne is my, without a doubt, Peterman of the week.
Yeah, because at this point, they're going to, it's the shoulder.
Which is, put him on IR. But, get on with it. Give us the bona fide, no, you can use Tank Bigsby.
Yeah. Well, then this isn't about a hammy. So now he's dealing with 2 injuries. The writing was on the wall for Travis Etienne to kind of have a down year. I just didn't believe it. I was Travis Etienne everywhere. But yeah, I agree. Now's the time for the IR. Now's the time to let Bigsby get the start, get the bulk, and run with it. Because we saw too much D'Ernest Johnson. I'm sorry. There's no need to have that much D'Ernest Johnson.
They also got walked.
When you got the three, you're getting your next stepped on. You're really just gasping for air, trying to figure out a way to get up, and that's all they were doing.
Keep our superstar Tank Bigsby on the sideline.
Let's keep getting him in the landing zone to return kicks, which he did look good there. Tank Bigsby. It was a week. Thanks for the comment.
Rising star of the week. The biggest value bump this week coming out of week 6 goes to who?
For me, I'm going to actually stay with the New England Patriots. It's Drake Maye.
Homer, boo.
I know.
Homer, boo this man. Boo.
I know. But Drake Maye, he did one thing that fantasy, NFL, Patriots fandom, doesn't matter. One thing that he did that across the board is impressive. The moment was not too big for him. And with a quarterback who's that green, who has that much development to have happen, with that much uncertainty with the offensive coordinator and the new head coach, it felt like this could be a moment where Drake Maye was put into a situation where he got absolutely blitzkrieg, and he did. Mm-hmm. Early on, they pinned their ears back. They were getting after it. I think it was a 21-0, 14-0 for sure. And then deep touchdown pass to Kayshon Booty. Great throw. And the game was never close. But I think it'd be hard fought. And again, this is my homerism. I'm sorry. I've been away from home. I'm homesick. What do you want me to do? Yeah. I'm homesick. I think it'd be hard fought to find a closer 41-21 game in recent memory.
You're fucking on me.
I just felt like he punched back. And if that was Jacoby Brissett, it's 41-3.
Well, I think the stat, as we were walking down King Street, that I pulled out Twitter, and it was like, Drake Maye has more touchdowns this week than Jacoby has in the first five.
That's right.
And that's all you need to hear.
That's exactly. And he's going to finish with over 20 fantasy points. He had three touchdowns. He did on 243 passing yards. 60% completion percentage. Not bad. You know, it's not what we wanted to see, but for a first start against a tough defense, he was able to come out and hold his own. And I think there's some optimism surrounding that offense and that quarterback. And they have a lot of holes to fill. A lot of holes to fill. So in no way, shape, or form am I here to say that the Patriots are good. The Patriots have arrived. Bop, 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 bop. What I do think they can say, and us in fantasy can say, is that the asset that is Drake Maye will be a valuable one. It will be one that's worth. Because remember, due to this coaching staff, due to the uncertainty and how things were going, I had almost written Drake Maye off in August. We were on this very show talking about Drake Maye and
his
potential.
You were hyped for Joe Milton.
I was never hyped for Joe Milton. Never was once time hyped for Joe Milton.
I remember you coming back from training camp saying Joe Milton's a starter.
No. I said that. I did say this. Joe Milton is built for practice.
Yeah, that's right.
Because he is a big kid, laser rocket arm, fast, agile. When you're in basketball shorts and t-shirts, it'd be tough to find a better looking prospect than a Joe Milton. But in terms of Drake Maye, you know, we were using the 103 in Superflex draft.
Steep.
He came at a big price, and you had nothing to show for it. It's tough in fantasy when the team who sucked, who had the 101, gets Caleb. The team who sucked the second least gets Jaden Daniels. They're probably an improved team. They're off to the races. They have a vision, attraction, a little bit of foresight to the better things in life fantasy-wise. And you were sitting there with Drake Maye being like, I got nothing. My team is probably still not as strong as it could be, yada, yada. So now that he's on the field, it looks like the team's going to suck, but there will be better days ahead. And let's hope that Kelvin Banks can be the franchise's
Higgins
left tackle. We talked about that at lunch today. T. Higgins, give him the bag, sign, draft Kelvin Banks. The ace move, the A++ move is getting the 101, trading back to get the haul, still getting Banks. And then draft T. Higgins.
That's the nuts.
That's Elliot Wolf's wet dream, to be quite frank. But yeah, Drake Maye for me, a big riser, because I think now we can just breathe, we can exhale that, all right, we're not going to have the next Mac Jones. We don't have the next Trevor Lawrence. You know, it's maybe too early to say for Trevor, because we've had some hype around Trevor, blah, blah, blah. But it seems like Drake Maye will be a good fantasy quarterback.
I'm going to go to New York, where we watched him last night. And I was riding my bike. You called me this morning and you go, did you watch that game last night? I go, yeah.
Tyron motherfucking Tracy.
And I go, he's the one. And you're like, yeah, but Devin Singletary.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah, but guess what? He's still Devin Singletary.
He's still motor.
Still Devin Singletary. And still doesn't matter. Because Tyron Tracy got 23 opportunities in this game,
mm-hmm,
and went for 100 yards again.
Yep.
107. And a touchdown. 6 of 6 in the receiving game. And he looks good doing it.
Yep.
He doesn't look like... So don't take this the wrong way. I think a decent comp for him, a decent comp through 6 weeks for Tyron Tracy. Again, don't overreact to this. A decent comp for Tyron Tracy's career arc and future is Kamara Light. Not because he's as talented or because he has the, and I often comp using playstyle comps. The playstyle is comparable, but it's more of the situation on a team that is not as good and a team that needs to throw the ball a lot.
Yep.
They're down a lot. You can see how inefficient he is in the run game. A lot of games, you'll go back and look at Kamara's rushing lines, and it's like, what the fuck? And then you look at the receiving line, and it's like...
7 for 82 and 2 touchdowns.
What the fuck?
Yeah.
Right? And that's kind of what I can see from Tyrone Tracy potentially becoming a thing. Well, he was a receiver in college.
Yep.
He goes to Purdue and run it. Twitches running back. He does great. 2.9 yards per carry. 6 for 6, 57 in the receiving game. He's built similar to Alvin Kamara. The problem is he doesn't quite have the contact balance. He's not quite
very few player. Do. Yeah.
It's an elite trait that Kamara has. So that's why I'm saying take that completely lightly, but it's a Tracy light. Think about it that way. It's not as extreme of a take it lightly as the Chris Ivory, as what they call him. They called him the
I don't know.
It was like it was beast mode, but it was for Louisiana. Cajun beast mode or something like that.
This is before he got taken over by Alvin Kamara, right?
This is like 15 years ago. I'm saying like,
no, was it Chris Ivory the running back that?
No, I think
had
he was.
To get pushed
I think he
aside?
Was a couple behind Kamara though. But
was he
a couple years before? But I'm more so not New Orleans. Bringing up New Orleans is that's not really what I was going for. I was going for like when I'm saying like the comparison, right? Marshawn Lynch was different.
Yeah,
Chris Ivory was sick, but Chris Ivory couldn't hold Marshawn's jock.
No, Marshall was a first-round draft pick, yada, yada, yada.
And Tracy is sick. He can't exactly hold Kamara's jock when it comes to his talent and his contact balance and stuff like that. But I'm saying, like, I don't think it's as extreme. I don't know why that came to mind, but that's kind of where I was at. So there it is. Tyrone Tracy, the biggest riser on our favorites of the week.
Would you move him, though, in Dynasty right now? You wouldn't?
Well,
if it could get you in something, in a situation. I mean, Tyrone Tracy in a second, get you Alvin Kamara?
I'd hold Tracy my second.
Yeah, so you think it's something that's going to be replicated over the rest of the season?
Yeah, I don't think it's going to be an elite thing, but we talk about it.
If Singletary was done,
I think
you could replicate that, because I think that when you watch that game, I don't think Tracy stood out as a baller.
Where's Eric Gray at? Where's Eric Gray?
That's my point. Is that
where's he
the
at?
Opportunities were there, and they went back to Tracy. Tracy was the guy. My issue is. With the inefficiencies, if Singletary gets the lion's share and they have to phase it to a 50% share, are you just kind of left holding your Schmenzer in your hands?
I think
with a guy like Tyrone Tracy.
I think if we can somehow come out of this with a third down roll for Tracy.
Like a locked in for sure. That would be very encouraging.
And then I think next
very,
year
very
that Singletary is gone.
If
the way the season goes the way it goes. And the way he was coaching last night, Dayball, I mean, he was coaching for his job.
He's coaching for his job every game.
He went for it on fourth down how many times?
3 or 4. And the thing, it wasn't even that he just went for it. He went on his own territory.
Fifth down. Jesus Christ. Their third down conversion was 5 for 15. So that means they faced fourth down 10 times. Felt like he went for it like 6. I don't have a stat directly here. I wish I did. Probably should have prepared for that. But the
thing is, though, he did it in a way. I think Daboll's a good head coach. I think the Giants would be stupid to let him go after this year, regardless of the outcome, because he's a good head coach. He's a ballsy head coach. He gets a lot out of his players. Last night, going for a fourth down in your own territory multiple times, he didn't get burned by it, though.
You could tell he knew. I really wish I had a stat for this. He knew he needed to do it, though. That's the problem.
Yeah, he knew he needed to do it. And he also had a good feel for the game. You know, we talk about the difference of analytics and feel. That was a classic example of having a good feel for the game where he knew, the Bengals weren't scoring either.
Yep.
So he went for it, and he didn't get it one time. He did get it a couple times, but he wasn't burned by it. He didn't get lost in the minutia of coaching. He was able to give a good feel for the game. And push it forward. So I like Dave, but I think it's encouraging. And I think that as a fantasy gamer, going into next week or going into whatever week Singletary returns, a role, a defined role, I don't care. Let everybody, like Jason Kelce said, analytics are for nerds are losers. Let the nerd losers care about the percentages. I want to know, is there a defined role? Because from a role, he can carve out more of the percentage. He can carve out more of the opportunities because prospect for prospect, we agree. Tyrone Tracy, I think, helps your team better than Devin Singletary.
Yep, I agree. Let's finish it out with the hurdle rating, Matty. We just finished these up.
Live and in person, baby.
Live and in person, the hurdle rating. We'll start out with number 11 because that's where the tier break comes in, is between 11 and 12. And just to tell you who 12 is, just the bottom of this tier, is Seattle. So number 11 this week is a team we just talked about, the Chicago Bears. We've talked about this being the Madden team. They're in their opportunity right now to win games before this winter hits Chicago. Do we think this team is starting to look like they can withstand? I know Caleb is starting to look like he's going to withstand and push this team as far as they can get. But do we really believe in this team as a top 10 team in football? We have them at 11.
I had them inside my top 10 personally. So I do believe that they are they're here. And, you know, Lombardi always calls them the Madden team. And that's really just because they chose Rome Odunze over Byron Murphy.
Pretty much.
That's literally all. Like,
and paid Swift.
Right, but they were going to pay some running back. They were.
Yeah, but they had Herbert and Roshan. That was those two.
Yeah, but Swift is clearly better than Herbert.
Correct. But what I'm saying is I think that those two things both work together in pushing Lombardi to that thought.
Yeah, that makes sense. But I still think even if they signed Swift, had they taken Byron Murphy at 10,
he would be or 9,
that he wouldn't call him the Madden team. I think he called him the Madden team because Keenan Allen was free 99. They gave him, like, what, a fourth and got a sixth with him or whatever it was. It was nothing. And then DJ Moore came the year prior and they extended him, blah, blah, blah. But the reason why I like this team is, you know, you can say what you want. I've had my criticisms of the coaching staff so far. I still think they made the wrong decision. I still think Ryan Poles made a couple of wrong decisions. One, keeping Eberflus, and two, choosing Shane Waldron over Cliff Kingsbury because Kingsbury has that connection with Caleb, yada, yada. But the defense is strong. They're tough. They don't make it easy for opposing offenses. Of course, Jalen Johnson on the outside is one of the best cornerbacks in all of football. But Tyreek Stevenson's coming into his own. And even with certain injuries, you know, to Brisker and Simone Biles' husband, I forget his name. Kyle Gordon got hurt this week.
Yeah, Kyle Gordon got hurt this week.
But
I don't know who Biles is. I can't remember.
Jonathan Owens, you know, he's been hurt. They're still good. And then I'm watching this game, and I completely forgot that Kevin Byard's there. And that is like, I mean, you get that guy when you think you're about to, you know, ascend to that level of competition because he's a difference maker. He's like a pro's pro. And Ryan Poles has also shown that he's not afraid to make a trade in season. And I just wonder that if they are able to get that anchor D tackle that they didn't take at the with the top 10 pick, if they can get it with a future second, because remember, they still have one more pick from Carolina. So they still have another bullet to shoot off if they want to do it now instead. Wait, I think this team is built to be successful. I think what hurts them the most is the division that they're in. The NFC North is hands down the toughest division in football, and it's probably not even within a country mile.
You know who makes the most sense? This is the first name that came to mind when you said defensive tackle. They need a defensive tackle, potentially making a move for one. Not because I think this guy would be open to leaving his home, but because I think he looks perfect in that Bears uniform and in this Bears defense, is Jeffrey Simmons.
Yo.
But I don't know if they're ready now, so maybe like a thing that happens in 2025. Well,
they just lost again this weekend.
Yeah.
And they look as rudderless as a team does in the NFL right now.
It's brutal.
I mean, you have Calvin Ridley bitching about targets in post game. You have, you know, D-Hop can't be happy.
Levis sucks.
Levis.
95 yards.
Let's talk about Will Levis.
His highlight of the week was tearing a Cowboys ACL. He's on the streak of a lifetime right now.
Will Levis's and one mixtape for lowlights this season is Hall of Fame worthy. Dude. It's otherworldly, his lowlights between all the Favre bonehead plays to lose games. I mean, he's lost multiple games because of his decisions. And then, of course, injuring the player, the wincing on the sideline. When you watch the full video, he wasn't crying. But when you snip it the way that the internet has, it looked like he was crying on the sideline. It's just this guy, man, he is having a rough go at it. And unfortunately for him, he doesn't have the skill set that keeps you around the league. You know, he doesn't have that future backup in the league. I think like a guy like Daniel Jones has a little bit more of that floor that can keep you in the league as a backup, like Trubisky has been able to do and things of that nature. Will Levis is more like Blake Bortles. I don't think he's going to have many opportunities as a backup after this season.
We're done with that. All right. So that was our number 11 team. This is a three-way tie for 8, 9, 10. So this is technically tied 8 here. This is the Philadelphia Eagles, the Buffalo Bills, and the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. You have the Eagles at 10, Buffalo at 11, and Tampa at 12. I have Tampa at 8, Buffalo at 9, Philly at 10. So I have them completely the opposite order of you. You have them in this direction. I have them in that direction. Why do you have Philly ahead of Buffalo and Tampa? Because I can say, from what we've seen from Tampa, I, at this current stage today, believe more in Baker Mayfield and the weaponry in Tampa and the run game and the offensive line, the defensive line in Tampa than I do of anything I've seen from Philadelphia at this point. And I have them a touch ahead of Buffalo for the reason weaponry. And I don't quite believe in Buffalo as a play calling staff, aka McDermott and Joe Brady and that whole circle thing. So that's kind of why I have Tampa ahead of these guys.
You're probably accurate there in that assessment. I guess it's the they've had some bad losses, trusting the Buccaneers, but Buccaneers were a playoff team against last year. They beat the Eagles in the playoffs last year. The Eagles are the Madden team. The Eagles are the fucking Madden team. And they're the team that, you know, I can't. You just look at the roster and you still, I'm still wondering myself, when is Quinion Mitchell and Cooper DeJean going to make a difference? Because they haven't yet.
It's tough, man. It's tough for these cornerbacks, dude.
I watched it.
Year after year after year with fucking Zimmer drafting Trey Waynes and Andrew Booth was there and fucking Xavier Rhodes and all these guys for cornerbacks, especially these high end guys. Sometimes it's elite, but even Sauce Gardner struggled at times when he was a rookie. Like it's, I don't know. It's a big ask to just say come in here and. Slay's right there and Bradbury's right there, and the stress really is on Quinion Mitchell to take the job from those guys because they were a bit of a sieve last year.
Yeah. Well, they've been this year.
It's a tough ask.
So I guess it's just when I look at the Madden roster, I still don't want to give up on the Eagles, but they're another team. The Eagles and the Cowboys are going to both look on this season and go, we could have had Bill fucking Belichick,
dude,
running the show. We have now let Dak get a year older. We have now let AJ Brown get a year older. We've let all of our superstars age a year, get a bad taste in their mouth, quite frankly, when they could have brought in Bill Belichick, got this thing going, and I don't know if they would be light years better, but the mistakes that we're seeing from teams like the Eagles wouldn't be there with a Bill Belichick-led team. I guess maybe I'm just letting the history or the roster, whatever you want to call it, the Eagles, stick in my brain too much because I think of the three teams that you mentioned, the only one that I actually feel positive about is the Buccaneers. I don't feel positive about the Bills. I think what we saw was Josh Allen being an otherworldly talent, kicking the shit out of bad teams. The step up in competition came like a ton of bricks, and now they've lost three in a row. They have a tough game or... Is it 3-1? Maybe I'm foreshadowing the loss against the Jets. I think the Jets suck too, so the Bills could win. Either way, I just don't know if the Bills are not prepared to win. They're not built to win. They don't have what it takes to win or make a deep run in the playoffs. The Eagles, I guess they don't either. I guess maybe I'm just kind of was wrong with that. Because the Buccaneers, as I'm talking about, seems like the team. You know, they have a good team, and they are the only one of this three that I actually feel good about. And now that the Broncos are looking at least not like a complete nothing, maybe that loss isn't as bad as I've given it credit for.
Number 7 for us is the San Francisco 49ers. Matty has them at exactly 7. I have them at 11. They're starting to get back their weaponry. Debo, Kittle, Ayuk's looking better. McCaffrey, we're expecting to be back in the next couple of weeks.
Yeah.
That timeline is so maniacal to me with McCaffrey. Team I want to talk about, though, and I think that deserves a little bit of conversation here, is team number 6 for us. I believe my math is wrong. This is team 7. Okay. Washington Commanders. You have them at 8. I have them at 7. They just lost to Baltimore by 7. Do we still think this is a good team? I love what Frankie Louvu's done. I like that this is a no-name defense outside of the Jonathan Allens. But what do we think of Washington? Jaden Daniels is a wagon.
Yeah.
But can this team withstand? We just talked about earlier, buy, sell. Are they going to make the playoffs? We think so. Are they going to be competitive is the next question. And should they be maybe below the Tampa tier?
This is a team
in reality, I guess I should say.
I think in the thing about the Commanders that is going to hurt them the most is something that's really outside of their control, right? There are these factors. Whenever you're trying to predict the future, internal factors, external factors, this is an external factor. The NFL doesn't make trades. If it were like a baseball where trades happen at the deadline, this would be a team. This is a team that would, if I was Washington, I think T. Higgins, adding him right now would be huge for that roster. Adding a pass rusher off one of these bad teams would be huge for this roster. If they could just undo the Sweat trade, get him back in a Commanders uniform, that would have been huge. But because of that, they might make a dink and dunk trade. I don't know if they'll make an impactful trade. But what I do like from the Commanders is you're seeing the O-line overachieve. So as, you know, throughout the course of the season, you typically see offensive lines saturate. They become a little bit more polished, a little better. And so if the Commanders are getting a lot out of their offensive line due to coaching, scheming, Jaden Daniels, what have you, that should continue to improve over the course of the season. And it's just Jaden Daniels is just, he's the real deal. And when you get the guy's real deal, we saw our CJ Stroud. There were conversations being had exactly like this a year ago. Are the Texans for real? And the Texans, you know, they hosted the Joe Flacco-led Browns, and everyone was putting money on the Browns. Joe Flacco can't be stopped. What happened that game? They kicked the dog shit out of the Browns, and then they lost pretty badly to the Ravens, but the Ravens, we all know, are pretty damn good. And yeah, this was a barometer. This was a litmus test, if you will, for the Commanders, and I think that they passed the test even though they lost the game.
I think that's fair. Washington, we already talked about their schedule the next few weeks. Pretty favorable.
Yeah.
Before they headed to that Philly-Dallas doubleheader. Number six overall is, in fact, the Green Bay Packers. We each have them number six. And then the top five doesn't really change that much, but we'll run through it here. Tied for fourth is both Baltimore and Houston. You have Baltimore five. I have them four. You have Houston four. I have them five. I love Baltimore just a little bit more. I think they got that win against Washington. We respected Washington. They've looked a little bit better on offense. I think the biggest thing for me, Matty, we talked about, we're sitting there in a bar watching this game, and I'm like, thinking to myself, this isn't Baltimore that we're used to.
Right.
Because they've either always had a run game with Lamar, and it's like Andrews, right? Or he throws for 300 yards to like Nelson Aguilar and this other bullshit.
Yeah.
And the first 2 weeks of the season, it was pass to Zay and Isaiah Likely. And then it was, we talked about this on this show.
Yeah.
What are they going to do if they got to get Derrick Henry going, or this is fucked. They got Derrick Henry going and some.
They haven't lost since.
Every week, right? And that was for week three and four, and then week five and six. It's been the combination of Zay work, of Lamar work, of Henry going, of Likely and Andrews or Kohler, like all three of these tight ends getting action. And then Bateman goes for 70 yards.
Mm-hmm.
This team, to me, as I'm putting the rankings in today, I debated putting them ahead of Kansas City.
I think that's fair. I think if Kansas City didn't win that game in week one, it would be a pretty obvious move. They're well-rounded. The reason why I have Houston ahead is I think punch for punch, the Houston offense with Joe Mixon, I think that was a...
Flowers.
Joe Mixon was a huge addition, such an under-the-radar addition for the Houston Texans. We saw him absolutely run wild on the Patriots. And I think that going from Singletary to Mixon is such an upgrade at that position that it's going to be huge for him. And then the difference, and I'm not saying Derrick Henry, Mixon's obviously, you want Derrick Henry, but the reason why I have Houston higher, the record, I'm going to lean into the record just a little. Also, head to head, when I think of them two matching up, the Danielle Hunter, Will Anderson combo in any given game can win, can be the difference maker.
Mm-hmm.
And the Ravens this year, they'll have a good defensive unit, but I don't think they're going to have a scary one as the season goes on. I don't think that they're going to have a unit that you're going to shy away from. I mean, heading into it, I mean, we were all starting our Jaden Daniels. We were all starting our Terry McLaurin with no problem. We were going to start B-Raw. We didn't, but we all were starting Austin Eckler with no issue. This defense doesn't present too much scariness like we're used to, where Stingley, Anderson, and Danielle Hunter is such a dirt nasty combo that if Baltimore just trails Houston because of that slow start and they have to go to Houston, I think it's going to be really tough for them to win. And I think Danielle Hunter and Will Anderson can make a lot happen against a run over a dynamic quarterback like Lamar.
And that was the difference in this week's rankings in the top five, was that Matty jumped Houston ahead of Baltimore to make it a tie here. In the top three, Kansas City, Minnesota are both on bye. Detroit got the mega win against Dallas. That impacted Dallas more than Detroit. Detroit, I still have it two. Matty still has it three. And then Minnesota and Kansas City, I have Minnesota at one. Matty has them two. He has Kansas City one. And I have Kansas City three. So that's the order. The order right now is Minnesota one, Kansas City two, and Detroit three. So we're not going to talk about that, Matty. What we're going to do is we're going to predict this Minnesota-Detroit score right now, because that's the game this week.
That's the game, yeah.
And for you, it's two versus three, and for me, it's one versus two.
I just want to say this real quick about the Lions. I was going to put the Lions at one. I was going to put them at one, but then to myself, like I try to stay consistent as I do these rankings. The only way that this can matter is if it's consistent.
Yeah.
And I just, if Minnesota and the Kansas City Chiefs played and won but just didn't pound, they might have dropped. But I just haven't historically dropped guys based on a bye. I wasn't going to start this week when they're both undefeated. But what the Lions did going to Detroit, they're the best. They're the best team in football. Yeah. They're just, their offense. I forgot that they drafted Christian Mahogany. You know, this is a little inside baseball. This is a little bit probably over the heads of the casual football
Boston players. College.
But Christian Mahogany was one of our favorite interior linemen through the draft process, and he didn't play because he was sick. But it was just another realization. This offensive line
deep
could stop the Avengers.
Top end and deep.
If the fate of the world rested on the Lions to protect Jared Goff against Thor, Hulk, and all the Avengers, Penei Sewell, Taylor Decker, Frank Ragnow, the whole company, holy fuck. They're unbelievable. And just the way they're winning, they're not out there. It's not like glitz and glamour. It doesn't look like the St. Louis Rams, the greatest show on turf. That's not how they're winning. They are just punching teams in the face. And when the team taps out, they're pushing the ref away and continuously punch the team in the face. Montgomery with this line is unbelievable. You can't stop him within inside the five. Jahmyr Gibbs is a weapon, and he's just, they're able to win so many different ways. And now we're seeing Goff.
Waymo.
Dude,
they went back to him back to back. We're standing there
watching the game. Horrible drop.
That's why you don't catch with your body.
Yep.
They go
horrible
right back,
drop.
Right back.
Same exact play.
A year ago, they
right
didn't
back.
Do that.
No, exactly. And he's getting the confidence in. And we're seeing it. And I know this sucks for our Amon-Ra St. Brown shares, but we're not seeing the dependency on him like we did in the past. We're not seeing the 12 targets a game because they don't have to. J-Mo's producing. Sam Laporta, regardless of his statistical output, is always going to have to be accounted for by opposing defenses. And then at the end of the day, if you don't put seven in the box, they are going to line it up, power eye, and they're going to run it down your throat, and they'll do it over and over. If you need a yard, they're going to get a yard, because what they could do is they set a perimeter and the running back doesn't even get touched for 3 yards. And as long as they stay healthy, I think this is the best team in football. Now, health. Aiden Hutchinson. Gruesome injury. Don't recommend looking it up. Reminded me of Anderson Silva when his leg unhinged when he kicked Chris Weidman in the leg, whatever, 6 years ago, whatever. It was and losing a guy like that changes a lot. It changes a lot of the dynamics. It changes a lot of the confidence in a defense. But if there were a team that can keep morale high, keep the competition and the grit and all that stuff high, it's Dan Campbell. It's the Detroit Lions. But, of course, losing Aiden Hutchinson, who was the best player in that draft class, was taken second overall, but he should have been the first overall pick in that class. It's going to suck losing him, for sure. And that they're a team that I could see spending a first-round pick to bring someone in.
Yeah, 100%.
If you're the Detroit Lions, do you offer your first for Micah Parsons?
You don't get it. They won't do that. I mean, yeah, you offer two firsts.
Right.
But also, I'm not sure he's a kneecap biter.
Yeah, he's a Texas guy. You know, I think Dan Campbell, I think right now the Detroit Lions are, they're their own culture. Yeah. If you're on the, if you join that locker room, I think you get that boost. I think they're there. I think they're finally there. But yeah, I don't know. I think that with the injury, knowing that Hutchinson's out for the year, it's not a, well, let's play it safe. Let's, no, he's done until 2025. No questions asked. So if there is a rush to get
Hassan Reddick, he's in that maniacal situation with the Jets. That'd be one that makes
sense. Well, Drew Rosenhaus was just hired to solve it, and maybe his solving is trade us somewhere or we're not going to play.
That would be an elite situation. So the Lions play the Vikings noon game. This one feels like if you could flex, which you can't flex these early games, it would be flexed directly into Sunday Night Football.
Yeah, do it.
Or at least the 425 game. So Detroit, before their bye, September 30th, played Seattle 42-29. They go into the bye. They come up 47-9. Minnesota, to this point this season, has only given up more than 17 points once. That was at Green Bay. It was a 31-29 finish. Everybody else, 17 for the Niners, 17 for the Jets, 7 for Houston, 6 for the Giants. They've scored 34, 28, 31, 23. Again, coming out of a bye are the Vikings after the Lions just came out of a bye. This is in Minnesota. Rivalry game. Not rivalry, but divisional game. And I will say, having attended at least five, I think I've attended six Lions games in my career, in my life.
And it was never
with the Vikings. Like it was never, well, I went in 2009 when Favre was there. That was, I mean, they weren't it. Lions weren't good, but the Lions.
That's what I'm saying. The Lions, all these Lions games that you've seen was not a premier matchup.
But it was. This is what I'm saying is the Lions always played them tough. Yeah. The Vikings never got dusted. I remember the first Vikings game I ever watched in my life was 2001 or 2003, and Kevin Williams won the game on a blocked field goal. It was like 23-21. This was like Joey Harrington Vikings.
Oh my god!
Against Dante Culpepper. Like the Vikings were clearly better.
Yeah,
didn't matter. The Lions always played them close. So this one is guaranteed to be close. I mean, we've had the Golden Tate games, Amon-Ra's had games. There's been so many.
Yeah.
And this it's a low-key, very good divisional matchup here. And then we're fighting for NFC supremacy right now.
Mm-hmm.
You got a score?
Do we have a line? Is there a line out on that game yet? Check and see if there's a line real quick, because I the thing I feel most comfortable in terms of predicting for next week has to do with the line. So I gotta see what the line is.
I'm gonna bet it's 1.5 Vikings, the total of 52.
I'm hammering the under. I the only way I'm not hammering the under if they come out with like a 41, 42 point, if they're sharp. If it's 45 or above, I'm hammering the under.
49.5.
Yeah, hammering the under. And hammering the under.
Where's the line at? 49.5.
This is going to be damn near a pick 'em game. Like I said, I could see the Vikings losing a point and a half because of the home field advantage.
These sites are so shitty.
Fix your sites. Internet.
FanDuel has it at 1.5.
That makes sense. I this is how I see this game. I see the Lions winning 20-13, 21-17. This is going to be an under 40-point game because this is just going to be, I think the Lions are going to come up.
Sorry,
and run.
I was wrong. Total's 51.
Yeah, hammer the under.
-1.
Hammer the under. Destroy the under. Bet the under all day long. Put the mortgage on it. Put the rent on it. Put everything on the under. I don't think that these teams come out and try to be hyper-offensive. I think they're both well-run organizations. They both have very good head coaches. They both understand what this game means in terms of the landscape of the NFC and certainly the NFC North. I think this is a low-scoring game. I think the Lions pulled off slightly 20-14, something in that ballpark, 20-17.
23-20 Vikings.
So we're locked up in it being a low-scoring game.
Yeah, so we're taking the under. Hammer that under.
Hammer the under. But this is the winner of this game. I will make this prediction. I will say now, and I will say with 100% certainty, the winner of this game will be number one in my hurdle ratings. They will jump the Chiefs.
That's fair. All right. Cody Carpentier, Matty Kiwoom, The Hurdle, episode
98.
We're getting close.
We're going to have to come back down for 100.
Appreciate you coming down, brother. Live episode. You guys got an hour out of us today. Way too long. Time to get some food.
Time to get some food.
All right, we love you. We appreciate you. Click that like button, click subscribe, and like I said, drop some comments because we ain't live, but we will reply to The Hive. Tap in, tune in every Tuesday night, 7 p.m. Eastern time.
Peace.